Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. And I know this is sort of like old home week for many people, but it would be great if we could all take our seats so we can begin. I have a few, well, just a couple of announcements to make before I introduce our keynote speaker. One of our speakers in the first session today, Denise Teese, is ill and will not be able to give her paper. So that will shorten the session, except that the speakers have all been told they can relax a little bit and maybe speak at slightly less of a clip than they would have otherwise. It will prolong the lunch hour a little bit, but then we'll all want everybody back at 1:40 for the second session. That's the kind of Friday the 13th element. Let's hope that's all. So that's it. We've got rid of that. And then, unfortunately, tomorrow, one of our speakers, Melanie Gibson, also had a very bad accident, and so she's not able to come. But her paper will be read by Denise Bayazit of the Department of Islamic Art at the Met. So it gives me great pleasure to open the proceedings of this symposium, Discoveries, New Research on the Collections of the Department of Islamic Art at the Met. As you all know, the department was closed for 8 years, and lest people think we were just sitting there idly waiting for the opening. In addition to plans for the physical exhibition of our collection, there was a huge amount of research that was done in those years. Some of it is now in the new book, The Masterpieces of the Collection, the Department of Islamic Art, and in other publications that have come out. But today is an opportunity for both people who work and have worked at the Met and others, other colleagues, to present their research, which maybe hasn't found its way yet into published form, and to show that, of course, it's the perhaps the core activity of a department such as ours. And so, to give our keynote address, we have Renata Holod, who is a renowned teacher of wonderful students, and now she is the College for Women class of 1963 professor in the Humanities in the History of Art Department, and curator of the Near East section at the University Museum at the University of Pennsylvania. In the many years that she has been teaching and curating at Penn, she has looked at so many different aspects of Islamic art. She's a specialist in the study of the visual culture of the Islamic world, and she has undertaken archaeological and architectural fieldwork in Iran, Syria, Morocco, Uzbekistan, Turkey, Tunisia, and the Ukraine. She's advised many boards, including the J. Paul Getty Trust, the Fondation van Berchem, and the annual Aga Khan Award for Architecture. She's also received awards, of course, and these include the Environmental Islamic Environmental Research Center Award in 2004, and at Penn, the Provost's Award for Distinguished PhD Teaching and Mentoring in 2010. She has published widely in everything from City in the Desert, which was the Qasr al-Hair East excavation report, to Architecture and Community, Building in the Islamic World Today, the Mosque and the Modern World, and also she has contributed to such books as the Timurid Architecture of Iran and Turan by Lisa Golombek and Donald Wilbur. Her research goes on. At the moment, she's the principal investigator in the Chungul Kurgan research project, which is taking place looking at a Kipchak Polovtsi 13th century tumulus in southern Ukraine. And so I could go on and on, but I would like to say that I've known Renata for so many years. She's been a stalwart friend and one of the most active people in our field. She always stirs up excitement, and she's the perfect person to start us off today, to kind of rev up our batteries and get us thinking about the broad questions of Islamic art, as well as some of the areas that you'll be hearing about in more detail later. So please join me in welcoming Renata.
Good morning, and I must say one thing before I begin my presentation, and this is, I find myself in a rather interesting situation of discussing new directions in Islamic art studies at the Met without actually having done any of them myself at the Met. So what I thought I would do instead is to feature some of the objects that are here, but to essentially discuss them from the point of view of the various projects that my students and I have been working on, and collaborators as well, over the last 10 years, more or less the time that the Met Galleries have been being worked on separately on the side. So I thought I would essentially discuss this aspect to the these approaches as we are looking at them over the next 2 days under essentially three categories. The first one is essentially call upon you all to think about the history of seeing. What I mean by that, first and foremost, is that it is what is written down about the nature of cultural seeing, including treatises on optics and treatises on art, but also trying to interrogate as many of the objects as we now have before us to begin to understand what they can contribute to our developing a history of seeing as it developed, rolled out in so many myriad ways and in not in a linear fashion by any means within the different chronological and regional categories of the Islamic world. And within this, I will try to show you two different experiments that I have undertaken to actually look at these in some detail. Secondly, the other category that I would like to propose for us to look at is the history of practice. And I know that the detailed examination of many of the objects that we will be discussing are actually, these detailed examinations have revealed for us, in fact, much of the process of making of these objects, and therefore giving us access to the theoretical geometric knowledge, the structural knowledge, the constructional knowledge of the artists and artisans that are essentially responsible for what we now have in this vast collection. Next and last, I would like to look at the history of territory. Any one territory, but as it is also reflected in the trade goods that it produces and receives, how we actually conceive of frontiers of these territories, and finally, what we can tell about the details of settlement patterns vis-a-vis centers, and maybe actually expand our imagination about what and how material culture encompasses the visual culture and then in turn the art historical practices. To begin with, I'd like to actually focus on the Safavid period. And of course, this tile panel that is here is up in the galleries. But it's only late that I came to it. I have to tell you how I began with this pursuit, my Safavid journey, and very quickly. It actually deals with the not so much the great Safavid center here, but in fact an area that is right here, a small suburb called Bidabad. And it is in 1122 or 1709-10 that Ali Kuli Aga, a eunuch of the Safavid courts of Suleiman and of Sultan Hussein, completed a pious foundation document which was intended to support a social service complex for this developing suburb of Bidabad. So this is already more than a century of Safavid Isfahan. His complex was to carry his name into the future in lieu of genetic offspring. And it would have been commissioned and probably built during this time, or probably from 705 through 715, as far as I've been able to determine it. And in an area that was changing, and here you see it, this is the mosque itself. Here is the old irrigation channel, which is now made into a paved channel. And the mosque itself also contains a madrasa on the second floor, strangely enough, and here you see it. And it is a rather small one, actually, but through the waqfiya, we know that it contained maximum of 12 students. But what I have found interesting about it is something else, that here are the upper windows of the madrasa, that the madrasa actually looks out onto this area. And here's the madrasa and mosque, and it looks out and across onto the entrances to this vast double bath. I shan't bore you with the details of the double bath, although it's actually quite interesting how it was used, but rather than having the students of the madrasa turn inward for their further enlightenment, they actually are looking out all the time. So by the beginning of the 18th century, there is a kind of a regime of looking that seems to have penetrated even into the furthest suburbs of of Isfahan itself. But what has been the greatest surprise is this area here in the swimming pool, because there we actually have a full program of paintings that I shan't have time to really get into, and of tile work. And specifically, I'd like to look very closely at this tile panel that once upon a time, of course, had much brighter colors that have since decayed. And also another panel next to it that I won't have time to go into. But the key thing is to understand that this panel, as well as the main one, is now part of a visual culture of Isfahan that not only takes in the great monuments that we are quite familiar with, of the Maidan itself and all of the other layout, but is actually, because it's there in the suburbs, now part and parcel of the decorative techniques that are available to any patron that would want them. But specifically, how did this come to be that this regime of viewing developed? And here I am going out on the limb, but this is actually the place to do it. If we look at the sequencing of buildings around the Maidan, we can actually see that it is actually a two-part affair. Basically, the Maidan is laid out within the last years of the 17th, beginning of the of last years of the 16th, beginning of the 17th century, and then sometime in the 20s, some of the buildings actually get added to. But it already established within this time a kind of regime of looking out. And it is no surprise then that all of these shops which were here had actually connecting, were either two-story or had connecting stairways from the back, which meant that the crowds that participated in the Thursday bazaars, in the polo games, in the various other activities that were here in this vast array of a Maidan, were actually developing a kind of habit, a spectatorial habit. So when finally the Ali Kapu itself gets an addition of the great porch, which doesn't happen in the first, to the extent that we can establish this in the first instance, but certainly by the middle of the century, you have the great overlook. And from then on, I would put it to you that there is a kind of a spiral feedback of seeing and being seen, whether it's within the talar, it's from the talar itself, or then progressively next to the additions of any of these great pavilions, including the Chel Sutun, and finally also in the great Huaju Bridge, for whose purpose, for whose opening we have a variety of wonderful poetry that was written at the time, beautifully studied by Paul Ozensky. And here I'll just take the time to read a little part of one poem. In the festivities for the opening of the bridge, which was completely lit for this purpose, there are a variety of festivities. And so let me now read this to you. With 100,000 eyes, heaven stared at the adornment, the gardens, and the festival of lights. As befits the banquet in this bower of hope, it strung the lute with Venus's hair, and its burning melodies, at its burning melodies, moths relentlessly fluttered against the lute strings like plectrums. Instruments were painted with wine. The festival of lights was made of song at this banquet. The king's stars and sun and stars happily broke the wishbone of the new moon. When I wrote the description of the feisty candle, the pen became a match and ink fire. By the end of the century, no matter what the actual political or even economic fate of Isfahan was, the inhabitants of Isfahan, and so too our patron of the complex in Bidabad, were certainly quite aware of this poetry, this lighting of the night, this spectatorial regime. And also the idea that it is not only what you experience, but what you actually experience from memory, and how you can actually add the recall in a feedback onto your current experience, such as Muin Musavir does in this remembered portrait of his master. So now coming back again to our little bath, here, why is it that we have what is essentially a view of the Chahar Bagh Avenue in 1710 or so? And I would put it to you that by then, thanks to the vast engagement in the material that is flowing into Isfahan from all parts of the world, and in particular via India and via the Dutch East India Company, the Muscovy traders, and many others, we have a variety of visitors that come and leave their impressions, both written as well as visual. And it's no surprise then that I find the best parallel to that pile panel to be, in fact, Cornelist de Bruyn's image of the Chahar Bagh. And what has always interested me is how is it that the tile works of Isfahan now produce views that are now completely engaged and acclimated and manipulated for an industrial purpose to tile a bath in a suburb. So that's my first example of the history of seeing and the kind of feedback mechanisms that we really should be thinking of when we move forward to try to reconstruct a wider, more culturally inflected history of seeing. The second, very much inspired by the series of lamps that are upstairs, but I then brought out and thought about it in a different way. During the process of my teaching the Mosque of Cordoba, I was able to develop a working relationship with the digital design media component of the engineering school. And because of this, was able to work out with them a kind of an aperçu I had had looking at the polylope screens of the mosque. Specifically, the screens that are here marking the location of the old mihrabs, and then finally the screens that are essentially surrounding the addition built under Al-Hakam II. And what is particularly interesting and fascinating to me is to juxtapose it with the kind of information that Ibn al-Haytham gives us about optics. I'm not making a one-to-one connection here, but just the juxtaposition, and particularly that the intent of the beholder, the deliberate effort to perceive the object, and the determination to distinguish its properties is something that is understood to be part of vision. But before I show you some of the our attempts to reconstruct what the 10th century interior would have looked like, let me just review for you where I am coming from. I'm coming from the vision science line, particularly as it involves our peripheral vision. And peripheral vision is not necessarily, is biological seeing and not cultural seeing, as well as the fact that we see the same hue as different depending on shading. And to do this experiment, I called upon several of my students, and we've used Maya in order to reconstruct the fly-through. And now I'm going to now show you this fly-through with several caveats, and you will see them as we go along. Okay, here it is now. So in order to, this is the first iteration where we built up the interior of the mosque from, of course, information that we've gotten in otherwise published materials. And we're talking about the experience of the first two areas as if they would have influenced the making of the third, that is the making of the Al-Hakam edition. And you can, I'm not really going to comment on the details. Those of you who know them will understand them. The idea was to be able to understand how are these arcades lit, and then not only that, but whether we, for instance, light the central axial nave more, so we've developed some polycandela to actually look at that. And then finally, how do you, would you imagine that somebody coming into the mosque, including Al-Hakam himself, would have actually experienced this space lit the way we've lit it, and also with the peripheral vision as well as the central vision. And the key thing here is, of course, that the peripheral vision gives you a constant series of segments that intersect one with the other, and not as we typically teach this material, sort of front on this way or this way. And it becomes particularly clear when you come in laterally, and even more so the way in which these arches begin to dance and intersect when you start coming in, and in a minute this will come up, in a way wandering through. And if we believe that there is such a thing as recourse to visual memory, and everybody who writes about visual memory, including people writing in the 10th and 11th century, actually comment on this. So here is another way in which this is experienced. So with the help of, as I said, my DMD students, we managed to sort of make a view of this. Lit in the first instance in this fashion, but as I think I'll hope to show, of course, we will tweak it even more because the lamps that we've shown here, which was the first edition, turned out not to be quite the lamps, turned out to be a problem in reconstruction. So this then brings me, and well, we're just about done with this. As you can see, then we turn. So what remains in the synesthetic memory of the habitual user of this space? And the Mosque of Cordoba comments on its connection, this has actually been well studied, with Umayyad past, but also I think that the Al-Hakam edition connects with its immediate past essentially by quoting its own interior. And what I propose to you is, in fact, the polylobed screens are, in fact, a quotation of the synesthetic experience itself. And in this sense, it is the genesis of this idea of polylobe screens is very, very different than its subsequent quotation and requotation and requotation until finally you get to the Moroccan courtyard upstairs. Okay. I think that's done. Okay. Now, let's close this and go back to the images. Okay. So, in our quest to refine the question of lighting in the mosque, we have had recourse to the glass industries. And so, very quickly here, I'm showing you what kinds of glass we've looked at. Including, of course, the poly candle I won't have time to deal with. But one issue that became very, very clear is, of course, that glass that is filled with water in a particular way actually throws what is called a caustic cone, and therefore illuminates a larger area than would normally be true if this was, for instance, completely filled with water or not at all. In that case, it has no lighting effect here. And so here is our next iteration now with all of these lamps lit halfway. But of course, there is still a major mistake because, of course, the floor, which Maya immediately reproduces as reflective, is not reflective at all. So this is my attempt to expand and extend on the problem of the histories of seeing. The next point I want to make, and I'm keeping track of time, I hope, Sheila, is the history of practice. And we will hear, I'm sure, quite a few details on this, both in terms of the specifics that were newly discovered in the campaign of study, conservation and restoration that we've just come out of. But I would like to actually look at how the two tools that we associate with the making of both calligraphy and images are described, and put to you that, in fact, there is a third tool that poetry has not taken up, and it is this one. And so here we have, from the excavation record of actually found at the University of Pennsylvania Museum, a pair of dividers or compasses. And it is actually, that's the third tool that actually functions when we begin to look at anything that is close to any kind of geometric construction, because without it, nothing that is a circle, a segment, an interlocking series of figures actually can exist. And it is only very recently in this current seminar that I've been working on with my students that we begin to actually look at this detail of a page of an otherwise rather commonly reproduced, and here you this page, as he's probably reproduced more times than we care to mention, in every handbook on Islamic art, yet we know that its companion is ripped and it is completely reset. But the key thing to remember here, and of course having had the opportunity now to study the Seljuk Quran at the Met, that the other tool that we need to really be cognizant of is the tool of the compasses. And my third point is the history of territory. How large is the Islamic world? What territories does it intersect with, and how? And I only will have time to actually consider this question of the drug jar. We have them everywhere. They come early and they come late. But what is actually much more interesting, and we see them here. Here's one in the Museum of Islamic Art in Qatar. Here is what is a second from the Freer Sackler Gallery, and this is the Met one. But now we have an opportunity to actually date this one very specifically on the basis of the Chungul Kurgan Kipchak tumulus burial, where it is one of the any number of grave goods that is buried together with a Kipchak chieftain before the Kipchaks either become Muslims or Christians in the Pontic steppe. And this is where it's found. And finally, what does it actually tell us? It actually reveals to us that this jar is actually simply a pill bottle, a fancy pill bottle, because Syria is the big pharma of its day. It trades with all of these places with a variety of goods. And so it's on the basis of this that we can then return and ask ourselves how it is that we actually approach the object, that its use must be as important as its make and as its dating. Am I okay? Okay. So finally, a location that yields hardly any art, we think. The island of Djerba, where I completed a survey some years ago, has this many mosques all told, and none would be represented here at the Met, unlike other materials that are. And they look like this, or they look like this. Some are only 10-man mosques, 20-man mosques, 40-man mosques. However, and when we look at the archaeological record in a different way, we find that indeed medieval Djerba has no towns, only a very densely settled farm estate territory. And it is on the basis of this that we actually have a very different sense of what is material culture out in the countryside. But even there, we must be alert to the fact that mosques do not tell us the entire story, domiciles do. And in the ruins of the island, one can still find a variety of houses, or let's say estates, where the reception rooms are actually no different, if smaller, than the kind of aesthetic that drives the construction of the Damascus room. And I think I will leave you to ponder these and essentially leave it to my colleagues who actually have done specific work on the treasures that are upstairs to continue these days. Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. I'm Mariam Ektiar, Senior Research Associate in the Department of Islamic Art, and I'll be introducing the three speakers of the first session this morning. And the session is entitled Book Arts of Iran and India. Our first speaker is Navina Haidar, who is curator and administrator in the department. And she's been in the department since 1999, during which she's been deeply involved in planning the new galleries. And Navina has recently co-edited a book of essays with Marika Sardar on the art of the Deccan, on the art of the Deccan courts, and is also working toward a future exhibition on the subject. She's curated several exhibitions at the Met and lectured on various aspects of the collection and other subjects, and was educated in universities of Delhi, London, and Oxford. The title of her talk is New Thoughts on a New Acquisition from the Welch Sale. Please join me in welcoming Navina Haidar.
Thank you so much. Recently, the Metropolitan Museum unveiled in its new galleries one of the most important acquisitions to have been made by the Islamic Department in the area of Indian mural painting. The picture depicts the Hindu goddess Bhairavi, the feminine counterpart of Shiva, being worshipped by him in the guise of a mendicant, the scene set in a cremation ground filled with decomposing bodies. It has been attributed to the artist Payag in 1630-35 and is thought to have been made for Shah Jahan, possibly as a gift for Jagat Singh, the Maharana of Mewar, who is said to have been a worshipper of the goddess at the time. Its horizontal format indicates that it was unlikely to have been meant for a Mughal album, and later notations from the Mewar Royal Toshakhana, including a Devanagari inscription identifying the subject matter above, confirm it having been in that collection. And that's the Devanagari, of course. And this is the reverse of the page, which shows various inscriptions from the Mewar Toshakhana. The submission of the Maharana of Mewar to the Mughal prince Khurram, the future Shah Jahan, in 1614, is captured in this folio from the Jahangir Nama, painted by Nanha in 1615-18. The episode portrayed followed a long effort by the Mughals to expand into Rajasthan and bring into the Mughal fold one of the senior most houses of the Rajput royalty, the Sisodias of Mewar, described by Jahangir as never having bent their necks to any ruler of Hindustan for their 461-year reign. After Prince Khurram's fierce siege of Udaipur, a peace treaty was negotiated, and while the Rana was obliged to relinquish legendary Rajput pride and pay homage to the Mughal emperor, the terms of the treaty were fairly generous to the Mewar clan, requiring that Rana Amar Singh need not surrender territory or wait upon Jahangir in person, but could send his son Karan Singh to court instead. Amar Singh is shown paying obeisance to the Mughal prince Jahangir. You can see him in the submissive posture there, and to Mughal prince Khurram, and Jahangir describes the episode in his memoirs as such. My son, meaning Khurram, also behaved to him with perfect kindness. When the Rana clasped his feet and asked for forgiveness for his faults, he took his head and placed it on his breast and consoled him in such a manner as to comfort him. He also presented him with superb gifts. The restoration of good relations is reflected in the fact that during his rebellion against his father in 1623, Prince Khurram sought refuge in Mewar and was housed at the water palace of Jag Mandir during that period, and later renewed contact with Rana Karan Singh, the son of Amar Singh, at the time of his enthronement in 1628. These exchanges may well have laid the ground for the exchange of gifts during the period of his son, Jagat Singh, including one in 1633. And there is at least one other parallel tradition in the Rajput court of Kishangarh, which says that a portrait of the spiritual leader Sri Vallabhacharya by the Mughal artist Hunhar was given to the Kishangarh ruling family as a gift in the Shah Jahan period. The Met's collection also has one more painting connecting the world of Mewar rulers to that of the Mughals. This portrait of a royal elephant, which was captured during the Mewar campaign in 1614 and probably painted by the Mughal artist Bichitra. These various historical connections to Mewar and their reflection in the arts help us create a context for the present Bhairavi painting. Now, turning to the Bhairavi painting under discussion, the extraordinarily imaginative rendering of this subject, from the powerful image of the Devi or the goddess to the funereal landscape of seven funeral pyres and scattered body parts, expresses an idea central to Indian religion: the recognition of the forces of eternal universal destruction and the cycle of life and death, visualized here as an expression of Shaivite devotion. Perhaps some of the best descriptions of the goddess come from its former owner, Stuart Carey Welch, from whose sale this work was acquired. He says, "In this blazing picture, Bhairavi burns hottest. Spear points spoke from the goddess's lustrous, writhing tangle of waist-length hair, the blackest black of the composition. Three of her forearms uphold a trident, a sword, and a severed head. Her fourth arm extends a gentle open hand, the Abhaya Mudra, in a promise of freedom from fear by the goddess who is beyond it." Recently photographed in high resolution, we are now able to offer extraordinary close-up views of this painting, which reveal many of the fantastic details of the work. And this was one of the funnest ones to compose. It's just so elemental, just the color and the spirit of the painting in this detail. But some things to note are the multiple tonalities of red on the face in order to show modeling and blood, as well as the use of the pigment known as Indian yellow to create the vermilion powder on the brow. The conceptual depths, in some sense, of the iconography by details such as the reddening of the corners of Shiva's eyes, as is seen in the inlaid eyes of temple deities, and also to note the more granular quality of the gold than is seen in Mughal albums of the period, as you see in his prana, or breath of flame, the expressive qualities of the decapitated head, whose furrowed brow captures his final emotion, the sense of temporality introduced by the varying stages of decay portrayed, from heads to skulls, from flesh to bone. So you have this withered up hand, and then this extraordinary human ribcage. And the headless corpse, whose toes digging into the ground give a sense of immediacy to the action, as well as touch upon the yogic concept of the coexistence of life and death in the body at the same moment. By contrast, the figure of Shiva is far more realistically portrayed, with Europeanizing elements in evidence in his facial treatment, musculature, and modeling. He is identifiable as the god Shiva by his iconographic particulars, which include a halo, ash-covered body, fifth-day crescent moon, trident with rumal or kerchief for garroting and binding the wicked, and his hourglass-shaped drum. A remarkable work by the late photographer Raghubir Singh, taken in 1989, of a procession of ash-covered, naked Nagababa holy men at Allahabad, highlights not only the realism of the last image, but also somehow shares the smoky, ghostly quality of Payag's work 350 years earlier. And I thought it was interesting to see how two artists engaged with the same subject matter in such different mediums. The more familiar form of Shiva with his top knot or jata was known in painting by the time that Payag made his painting, probably in all the early Mughal Ramayanas and also in the Ragamala tradition, as is seen in the so-called Chunar Ragamala of 1591, this one here. And that's a more sort of familiar vision of Shiva. But clearly, Payag was motivated far more by the work of the great master Govardhan, and many scholars have noted the parallels with Govardhan's famous painting of five holy men, from the Europeanized figure of the young, short-haired boy in the foreground to the billowing smoke and misty atmosphere. Payag, who was active from 1591 to 1658, had a long career that spanned three emperors, and is shown here in a self-portrait from a folio for the Windsor, from the Windsor Padshanama. As a painter, he has been described as having two styles. One, a formal crystalline style that is seen in his superbly polished imperial subjects, such as a folio from the Kevorkian album depicting Shah Jahan on a dappled horse. The second is a more intimate and personal style and shows subjects of far greater psychological depth, often executed in a smoky, moody style. Note here the subtle but distinct glow of divine light at the point where the spear touches the clouds, which hints at Payag's tendency towards understated illusion in both cases. And that was something that hadn't been noticed all these years, but again, under magnification, it was very clear that this little radiant bit of light had been included in the picture. The basis for the attribution of the Metz Bhairavi Devi painting to Payag are mainly threefold: the inclusion and treatment of skeletal remains, the style and prominence of the billowing smoke, and the falling figures in the outer border. All these notable and unusual features are found in an inscribed folio by Payag in the Windsor Padshanama, showing the siege of Kandahar by the Mughal army in the year 1633. And this is a detail, you can see the billowing smoke. I hope you can make out the falling figures. And there on the ground, you can see skeletons. These elements are also seen in another siege scene attributed to Payag in about the same period. A sense of temporality is introduced again by showing various levels of human life, from warring soldiers to one at the moment of losing his life, up there, to dead bodies, to skeletons. The skeletons are down here. The overall impression conveyed is that of a lengthy siege having taken place over time, not dissimilar to the sense of the cremation ground and the sense of the passage of time there. Our painting is attached to a page with gold-painted borders, which extend the theme of the main ground. Unlike Mughal album pages, which were usually bonded and finely split with paintings laid between them, here the mechanism is far simpler. While there has been some debate about whether the border is original to the painting or a later addition, despite the fact that it's not in an established Mewar style, much of the significant evidence for the attribution to Payag lies within the border itself. An examination of the border reveals new details and also offers added interpretations. The gold drawings in the border, while not the fine, polished, and formal gold work seen in Mughal album borders, are executed in an imaginative and in some parts masterfully impressionistic manner, quite unlike anything seen anywhere else. In a naturalistic arrangement, the border is laid out with scenes from sky to ground in a logical manner, with smoke plumes and birds in the sky along the top, European putti on the sides, and falling figures, probably adapted from European scenes of heavenly ascension and descent on the left. Pairs of jackals and other figures occupy the middle ground, and the bottom register is filled with Mughal flowers. And do note that little lion that you see there. It was hard to show this border. I had to increase the contrast a great deal in order to bring out the gold. The idea of using the border not just to extend the visual elements of the main composition, such as the smoke plumes, but also to its theme and iconography suggests that it must have been part of the original concept. In particular, the lion on the right-hand side, and I'm showing you a magnified version of that, relates directly to the iconography of the goddess as her vehicle or mount. Textual sources describe Bhairavi, one of the 10 tantric Mahavidya goddesses of the Shaivite tradition, as having a red body, weapons, and a lion mount. Details of the pairs of jackals that are in the main painting and those in the borders show that they're so similar in handling and spirit, and thus also reinforce the attribution of the border to Payag. So this is a pair of jackals in the main painting, And here you have a jackal in the border and another pair in the border again. Recently, it has been suggested that a European subject in Jahangir's copy of the Divan of Navai, presently in the Windsor collection, provides a source for some of the falling and rising figures also seen in the border. So you can see these figures that are unclothed and rising up, and some of them appear to be feminine figures, and our high magnification again shows that some of the figures in the border are in fact feminine as well. A recently published Devi Mahatmya series on cloth of the Akbar period has been suggested as an iconographic precursor within the Mughal tradition. The folio closest in theme to the Bhairavi painting depicts the goddess as dark-bodied, in keeping with her name Kali, the dark one. In order to achieve the red body in our painting, however, Payag had to make a significant departure into an unusually lavish application of a rarely seen red, cherry red color, and we're still working on analyzing what that pigment really is. Now, other folios from that Devi Mahatmya series of the Akbar period show the goddess in more benign manifestations, but also other stories from her conquests. And this actually has been useful for another element, which is the two demon figures that you see here, right down here, in one of the Devi Mahatmya pages, can clearly be related to demon figures in the border. And I've been trying to, talk to various people about what these figures were, because they didn't quite fall into a kind of recognizable demon type. It's a pretty rare demon type, but you can see quite clearly that the tall ears here and the horns here, which are shown here, indicate probably the same two vanquished demons now paying homage to the goddess. Now, one of the most extraordinary aspects of the Payag painting is the feature of the body parts and bones. These are fairly naturalistically portrayed and with a good degree of anatomical correctness. Yes, I have counted ribs. The manner in which the bones are scattered across the open landscape, however, signals a possible further European influence. Looking at contemporary European prints, many of which were in circulation at the Mughal court, therefore, was a most rewarding experience because many were absolutely bursting with skeletons and bones, particularly judgment scenes, crucifixion scenes, and allegorical works. Now, keep in mind this treatment here, this bone, that bone, the way the head is lying here at an angle, and then look at this sort of landscape. This print, which shows Christ's descent from the cross, shows a similar scattering of bones and even a comparable placement of the head. And there are several other prints of this kind, and I'm not sure we'll ever find a precise source or to be able to say that Payag is making a precise quotation, but there's enough evidence here, and in many other prints that he must have been aware of this tradition. Okay. Now, the examination under the microscope yielded one more discovery about the painting. There are seven funeral pyres in the painting, as I mentioned at the beginning, seven being a sacred number with many connotations. In some instances, we can see logs of wood at the base of the fires, such as here. Elsewhere, where the fires are shown on the horizon line, such as this one, they rise from an undisclosed source. The flames are usually painted on with fairly dense and opaque curving lines, changing from fire to dark smoke. You can see that smoke rising. However, the seventh and the largest fire is also unusually translucent. And at its core, it appears to contain the extraordinary feature of a burning corpse within it. So this was a very exciting thing to discover. And when I looked closely at that wood, the little piece of wood that you see going into that fire, that particular knot of wood, which you're seeing shown straight on and then upside down as well, made us think about the whole tradition of hidden inscriptions which are well known in this period, and in fact it's been discovered that Bayag's hidden inscription is known in other works in our collection, in one particular work, the dappled horse that I showed you. I'm not sure that this is an inscription, but I'm not sure that it's a plain old simple knot in the wood either, because every other piece of wood in the painting looks like this. So I leave you with a final radiating image of the goddess, and just to say that these discoveries have all come through sort of close examination of this work, and we're very fortunate at the museum to have access to the kind of extraordinary labs and microscopes and so on that we can work with and further understand the collection. So thank you very much. And I am now told that we can also take a few questions here and now, if anyone has any. Otherwise, I'll pass on to the next speaker. It's quite possible, because I really did go into the whole business of the ribs, and it's a complicated world of ribs. I mean, there's so many pairs, and some are floating and some are false, but he seemed to have a good understanding of that anatomy. I mean, better than one would have imagined. And then also the pose of some of the objects, and yeah, it's quite possible. I haven't actually seen anything in terms of evidence, but that's a good avenue to explore. Yes?
I noticed that the gold border that you did attribute as possibly being original to the work. Mm-hmm. I see that a lot with the Safavid period. I've never seen it in the Welch illustration. I'm just wondering what the connection is there, why you might have chosen to illuminate the border in that way.
The gold border? So you do, you have by now a tradition of illuminating gold borders in various ways in the Mughal world. I mean, you have, right from the beginning. But you mean the free...
The fantastical beasts.
Well, I think it's really to do with this extraordinary iconography. That border does stand apart. I mean, it stands apart from the world of borders. It's much freer, much more impressionistic. It doesn't have all, it has some of the formal qualities of Mughal borders, the rows of flowers, but then the billowing smoke and those animals and so on are sort of new and sort of either out of his imagination and of course directly related to the iconography of the main page. So it's a stand apart border. There's no question about that. Okay, thank you.
Sheila Canby is the second speaker in the first session. She is Patty Cadby Birch Curator in Charge of the Islamic Department at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And until fall 2009, she was curator of Islamic collections at the British Museum. Sheila's publication include Persian painting, Islamic art in detail, Shah Abbas and the remaking of Iran. And at the Met, she was one of the editors of the masterpieces of Islamic masterpieces of the Department of Islamic Art, and author of the Shahnameh of Shah Tahmasp, two books published in conjunction with the opening of the new galleries. She continues to do research on Persian art, both Safavid and earlier periods, and hopes to curate an exhibition on Seljuk art with her colleague Denise Bayezid in 2015. The title of her paper is Thoughts on Some Safavid Works on Paper in the Collection. Please join me in welcoming Sheila Canby.
Thank you, Mariam. So the curators of the Department of Islamic Art have directed much of their attention in recent years to research on works that are on exhibition in our new galleries and are published in the Book of Masterpieces from the collection. However, with works on paper, textiles, and carpets, we have also been looking ahead to what would be placed on view when we rotate these light-sensitive objects. Thanks to the depth of the collection, even when a painting or carpet is not slated for rotation, it may be a worthwhile subject of research. So in this spirit, I have begun to examine some of the Persian paintings in the so-called Davis album, a collection of 33 paintings and one drawing bequeathed to the Met in 1915 by Theodore M. Davis. Before proceeding to the paintings from this album that I will discuss today, I would like to say that my colleagues, Navina Haidar and Mariam Ekhtiar, have already contributed substantially to the study of this album, along with the late Mimi Swetikovsky, and that Anastasia Bochkareva, a graduate fellow at the Met this year, is also discovering new information in the album's pages. The particular focus of my paper today is this folio from the album containing a painting of a group of water birds surrounded by a floral border that incorporates the images of two figures that appear to be based on European prototypes sideways. Excuse me. This is one of four images in the album with floral borders, whereas the rest have simple buff or salmon-colored outer borders with one or two narrow inner borders in blue or other contrasting colors, decorated with gold flowering scrolls. Given the difference in border decoration and the fact that the four images with floral borders are all Persian, rather than the Mughal-Persian mix of the others, this group most likely came from a different album originally and was joined with the others at the time the album was placed in its early 19th century Persian lacquer binding. Of the four pictures with floral borders, two are inscribed with the name of Ali Quli Jabadar, one with the name of Muhammad Zaman, and this one is uninscribed. The album also contains one other work ascribed or signed by Ali Quli. Muhammad Zaman and Ali Quli Jabadar were Persian artists active in Iran from the late 1640s through the second half of the 17th century, both of whom worked for Shah Abbas II and his successor, Shah Suleiman. Both artists' work reflects the strong influence of European and Mughal Indian painting. Although we can assume that the person who ordered the compilation of the Davis album in its final form had a predilection for the works of Ali Quli, this does not necessarily mean that the painting of the birds is by this artist. So my inquiry today will treat the question of authorship, but we'll also look at bird paintings in a broader context of both Safavid and Mughal painting. The aim is not only to try to determine who the artist of the work was, but also if it is based on or inspired by a known prototype and where it fits in the range of Persian and Mughal bird paintings. Starting with the identification of the birds, we find a large mallard duck taking flight at the left and his mate swimming in the river or pond beneath his wing. Three smaller birds flutter behind and above the mallard drake's right wing. And of course, I have mallard ducks on the right, and you can compare the real thing with these ones. So the little ones may either be a breed of larks or warblers. One ornithologist has noted, or has described, the short-toed lark as flying up in a dense drifting cloud when disturbed, but it prefers scrub and fields while reed warblers inhabit swamplands. So they may be reed warblers. And anyway, there's a pair of small birds on the tree stump in the left foreground that appears to be chiffchaffs, though they may also be some kind of lark or warbler. The blue bird in the center is a purple swamp hen. while the large water bird on the right is a greater flamingo. At the lower right is a pair of Brahmani ducks, flapping their wings as they apparently rise from the water. Behind them, a bittern, probably the female black bittern, emerges from the reeds with a snake in its beak. Aside from appearing in the same painting together and occupying the same habitat, most of the birds in this painting have another thing in common. They all winter in India. While this does not preclude the possibility of their having come from or passed through Iran, it does suggest a link to India that needs to be explored. Was the artist an Indian or a Persian? Did he have a pictorial prototype for this work? Or if so, was it European or from elsewhere? Before turning to possible prototypes, as I mentioned, I'd like to examine some other bird paintings to compare them with this one and to discuss how the approach to the subject evolved over the course of the 17th century. In the Met's collection, one of the most beautiful and famous images of birds comes from the Mantiqa Ter, or Language of the Birds, written by Farid-e-Din Attar. Although the manuscript was copied in Herat in 892-1487 by Sultan Ali Mashhadi, its cycle of illustrations was left incomplete. By around 1600, the manuscript was in the possession of Shah Abbas I, who commissioned several of his court artists to complete the illustrations. This one, by the artist Habibullah, illustrates the concourse of the birds when the hoopoe addresses, wait a minute if I do this right, the hoopoe, no, it's not pointing very well. Anyway, sorry, I can't make it point. anyway, he is addressing the assembled birds at the outset of their journey in search of a king, a metaphor for the spiritual quest for oneness with God. Although the birds are not anatomically precisely correct, they have been identified by Mimi Swiatkowski. Some, such as the hoopoe, have a long pedigree in literature, and others, such as the crane, appear in Safavid paintings of earlier periods of the 16th century. Their verisimilitude is somewhat compromised by their role in the narrative, since they are all depicted as listening to the hoopoe, even if some flap their wings and while others perch quietly. Unlike the Davis album painting, the birds here are viewed from a distance. And I really wanted to avoid saying bird's eye view, but it might be. Anyway, positioned across a landscape with its rocky outcrops and a plane tree rising into the upper margin and a gold sky. The two text blocks at the upper right and lower left tie the painting to its place in the narrative. And the unsettling inclusion of a man with a musket at the upper right introduces the idea of a human predator to an otherwise idyllic scene. While I cannot speak to the likelihood of birds of these species appearing together in one place, their colloquy is essentially a poetic device made visual by this illustration. By contrast, if the Davis album painting has any narrative content, it is covert and possibly more connected to a visual prototype than any literary context. In terms of technique, Habibullah's work is precise, and brush strokes are visible only with very high magnification, as you see here. While it has been argued that he was consciously adhering to the stylistic model of Timurid paintings in the manuscript, his natural mode, as seen in this painting of a royal horse from the first decade of the 17th century, emphasized line and the finest brushwork. By contrast to the horse painting, the Davis album bird picture is much more painterly, and the birds themselves are larger in scale and closer to the picture plane than those in the concourse of the birds. By the 1620s, and most likely earlier, Safavid court artists had begun to depict birds in natural settings for inclusion in albums. The painting of a Persian white wagtail, up here, is the work of Rezaya Abbasi, the leading artist at the court of Shah Abbas I, dated 1634, the year of his death, or a year before his death. Anyway, it is not the earliest bird painting he had produced, nor was the idea original to him. In the inscription on a bird painting by him, dated 1628, now in an unknown collection, he stated that it was based on an original by Behzad, the famous late Timurid master. While the rendering of this bird is very accurate, its scale appears overly large in relation to the landscape elements around it. The bird stands with its feet on either side of a pink rock, out of which a small tree grows. Keeping in mind that actual wagtails are 6 or 7 inches long, this tree and the smaller one at the left are not so much anomalous in this setting as they are sort of unconvincing. We know that the bird is in nature, yet the landscape elements are only props, not realistic elements of its natural habitat. As I've suggested elsewhere, the likelihood is that Reza himself left the landscape elements to an assistant, most likely his son, Shafi Abbasi, who established himself in the 1640s and 50s as a bird and flower painter. The drawing at the lower right is his work, Shafi Abbasi's work, despite a later inscription and date associated with Muhammad Zaman. Drawn in three colors of ink, this picture presents a bird perched on a flowering branch, eating a butterfly or moth. Bees and another butterfly buzz around in the air, while out of the ground below, clumps of flowers emerge. It's a bit cut off, but you can see it on the left. Although the flowers and leaves of the plant on which the bird stands appear to be hellebores, the trunk is more like that of a tree. Likewise, the flowering plant at the left resembles an allium, and the one below the branch a type of fritillary. None of these flowers is unique to Iran, and the inclusion of bees and butterflies suggests that Shafi Abbasi was inspired by prints of birds, insects, and plants coming from Europe. From an album in the British Museum, we know that John Dunstall's illustrations to the third book of Flowers, Fruits, Beasts, Birds, and Flies, published in 1661, made its way to Iran, where one of its pictures was copied by an Iranian artist. Even though this drawing here is datable to around 1650, we can assume that along with significant numbers of Europeans who traveled to or through Iran came images that were of interest to local artists. However, while we can sense foreign influence at work in a drawing such as this, finding an exact model is challenging and often unsuccessful. Instead, details such as the distinct mounds of dirt, of earth out of which the plants grow appear to be borrowed from print sources, such as those that appear in some of the plates of Crispin de Passe's Hortus Floridus, based on the drawings of Jacques Lemoine and published between 1593 and 1603. And we see an example on the upper left. In addition, a watercolor formerly attributed to Lemoine on the lower right depicts a parrot eating berries perched on a tree stump that recalls the one in Shafi Abbasi's drawing, though, of course, the flowering stem is absent. In one of Shafi Abbasi's most masterful bird paintings, he maintains the juxtaposition of a bird and a flowering plant, though here the scale of the bird and plant may be more realistic than in his drawing. The bird combines elements of the European goldfinch and the desert finch, both small birds, and here it rests on the stalk of a narcissus plant that has attracted a butterfly and bees. As in the drawing, the narcissus grows out of a low mound, here covered with grass. According to its inscription, this work was produced for Shah Abbas II and completed in 1652. In its careful brushwork, palette of rich, saturated colors, and compositional balance, this work follows the Persian model of bird painting. While the green hillock may be a nod to European sources, the idea of producing naturalistic images of birds had been promoted in Mughal India by the Emperor Jahangir from the first quarter of the 17th century onward. In fact, on several occasions in his memoirs, Jahangir mentions asking Mansur, one of his leading artists, to paint a particular bird. One of them, a dipper, is in the emperor's album here in the Met, and this is on the screen. As is evident, Mansur has depicted the bird in its habitat in Kashmir and has shown it diving. You see there, that's one diving, and standing on a rock to capture the features of the bird on which Jahangir had remarked. While the finesse of brushwork and accuracy of portrayal are equal to those of Shafi Abbasi, the landscape adds an element of verisimilitude that is absent from Shafi's work. Even if the scale of the dipper on the rock, an 8-inch long bird, appears odd in comparison to the width of the stream and the depth of the valley and mountains in the background, the setting is rendered with a far greater degree of specificity than in Shafi Abbasi's picture. The differences in approach to naturalism between the Mughal Mansur and Safavid Shafi bring us back to the Davis album Bird Painting and questions about its authorship. As I mentioned earlier, since the other paintings in this album with floral borders are inscribed either to Muhammad Zaman or Ali Kuli Jabadar, one of these artists seems most likely to have painted this picture. Considering Muhammad Zaman, one can refer to a list of his works that Eleanor Sims published in 2001. Although it is not exhaustive, it does provide the groundwork for understanding the range of the artist's work and the relation of certain themes to certain periods and places. A tinted drawing dated 1649 is the earliest known work that's dated by Muhammad Zaman. But the bulk of his early dated oeuvre comes from the 1660s and early 1670s. Many of these are lacquer wares, with one exception, the painting of a night scene in the Met, datable to 1664 on the basis of 65, on the basis of its inscription and its subject. Let's just see if I have that here. Navina Haidar has demonstrated that the painting depicts one of two comets that crossed the northern hemisphere in close succession. And you just see up here that comet. The first in December 1664 and the second in April 1665. At the top of the painting, this comet streaks across the sky as two gray beards confer in the foreground, and in the shadowy middle ground, one of several figures gestures towards the sky. As Haidar has noted, strong Mughal influence is evident here in the composition and dress of the figures. Whether Muhammad Zaman traveled to India or based his work on an Indian model, his willingness to use foreign models, so well known from his works after European prototypes, clearly extended to the East as well as the West. Does this make him more likely to be the artist of the bird painting? If we review his other compositions, we find a group of works added to 16th century royal manuscripts around 1675 for Shah Suleiman, several paintings from the 1670s and 80s based on European print sources, and four paintings of flowers ranging in date from 1663 to 1693-94. The flower paintings do not include birds, nor did the landscapes in the album pages and manuscript illustrations feature identifiable birds in their landscape settings. While the absence of birds in Muhammad Zaman's work does not preclude a foray into bird painting, certain characteristics of his style are not in evidence in this anonymous work. First, Muhammad Zaman's foliage is formed of large clumps of leaves, unlike the bush at the lower right in the bird painting, where each leaf is distinct. Second, his brushwork tends to stippling. This technique is present in some passages in the bird painting, but in general, the artist has applied the paint strokes in strokes rather than dotting it. Like Mughal painters of the mid-17th century, Muhammad Zaman experimented with the effects of light and shade. While here, the birds are illuminated against a dark black background, cast shadows do not play a major role. Although we cannot deny Muhammad Zaman's willingness to experiment, he adhered to just a few thematic groups, and the flower paintings are the only ones that focus exclusively on a non-human, natural subject. Ali Kuli Jabadar appears to have been more eclectic and intellectually restless than Muhammad Zaman, working in styles ranging from traditional Persian to Europeanizing to Mughal-inspired. Although Masumeh Farhad has considered some of his work to show European influence through a Mughal filter, we do not yet have enough evidence to prove that theory. Rather, his earliest works, dating from 1647 to 1657, include a copy of a European print on the upper left by the artist Sadler, an original composition of a Persian historical subject on the lower right, and a copy of a Mughal painting. Early in his career, he appears to have been under the sway of Bahrami Sofrakesh and Sheikh Abbasi, two artists who painted images of Indian women alone or with a lover, in which the faces are heavily shaded, but the figures' bodies remain flat and unmodeled. However, by the 1660s, Ali Kuli was creating works in response to paintings by Muhammad Zaman, such as his night scene with the comet that comes from the Davis album. His oeuvre also includes a portrait of Shah Suleiman with courtiers and a European and servants, as well as the portrait of a Russian ambassador to the Persian court. Some of his paintings are very closely modeled on European compositions, and others appear to use European prints as a point of departure. Crucially, he also painted images of birds, one of which is signed. The undated image of a peregrine falcon on its perch with its hood lying next to it is signed by Ali Kuli Jabadar. The inscription reads, "Work or composition of the son of the old Ghulam, Ali Kuli Jabadar." The same inscription appears on Ali Kuli's portrait of the young Shah Suleiman, which most likely dates to the mid-1660s, shortly after Suleiman's 1663 accession that we just saw. The idea of portraying a royal falcon certainly originated in Mughal India. I mean, we see them in group scenes, but the portrait of a falcon must have come from the Mughals. And this painting with a false attribution to Mansur attests to this. Even allowing for the difference in subspecies, the colors of Ali Kuli's bird are deeply saturated instead of the soft texture of the Mughal bird's feathers, achieved through the application of thin layers of paint. A painting of a second bird in the St. Petersburg album bears no signature, but shares the same sharply focused quality of the falcon. This painting includes a lightly colored ground with rocks onto which one feather has fallen, and behind the bird's head, a bee. Oops, sorry, we've gone forward. We need to go back. There we are. So up there, that little black thing is actually a bee. The inscription states that this animal is called a morge rangbar, or multicolored bird. But the bird itself may be more of a confection than an actual type. Its markings and tail are closest to those of the tragopan, which inhabits the Himalayas. But that bird is red, not blue, and does not have a feathered bib. It does, however, when it's mating, have some kind of wattle that comes out of its throat, like a bib, and it sort of shakes it around and jumps up and down in front of the female that it's trying to impress. Anyway, its markings and tail, as I say, are closest to this tragopan. Now, the artist may have produced the image on the basis of a verbal description or of a drawing rather than actual observation. In any event, the tragopan is such a rare and elusive bird that we can be almost certain that the artist did not paint it from life. More importantly, can we attribute the work to Ali Quli Jabadar? Certainly both this and the falcon share characteristics, such as the plain background, additional details in the lower part of the page, but more importantly, the perfection of the brushwork and the rich saturation of the palette. As for the relation of this painting to other works, both here in Ali Quli's landscape of 1649, where we see at the lower left a flower growing out of rocks like this, and the one that appears in the tragopan picture, and the head of the bird, however, most closely resembles that of the purple swamp hen in the Davis album painting. The fine, long brush strokes in a slightly darker hue than the blue ground on each bird's neck are the same, as well as the subtle mottling at the top of each bird's head. If we can accept the Davis album painting as the work of Ali Quli Jabadar on the basis of style and a partial analysis of his character as an artist, the question still remains of what inspired the artist to paint this composition. Unlike the portraits of important birds, this is a scene of birds in the wild. The fact that more than half the birds are flying or have flown up into the air suggests that something has disturbed them. While one might imagine such a scene as a vignette in a larger composition, it is not customary in Islamic or Mughal painting as a subject on its own, except, of course, something like the Mantika Ter. European prints, such as this one of ducks in a wintry setting by Wenceslaus Haller from about 1680, however, depict birds and other animals in landscape. Another popular theme in 17th century European prints was hunting dogs flushing birds in marshy or other environments, shown here in a print of 1694 by Johannes de Ram after a work by Francis Barlow. Neither of the prints I have shown could be considered a prototype for the Davis album page, and both probably are date too late in the 17th century for Ali Quli Jabadar ever to have seen them. Another work, which is a tiny print, so it's a little fuzzy, by Hans Liefrink I, dated 1631, may be closer to the type of print Ali Quli would have seen. It depicts a hunter and his dog startling a group of ducks while long-legged water birds wade in the reeds at the right. Well, and I've taken half of it just to show what it would look like without the man in the picture or the dog. So they're all fluttering up, but we don't see what's done that to them in the lower detail. While Ali Quli painted birds that are native to West and South Asia, the germ of his idea may have originated in one of the many European prints that traveled eastward with traders, diplomats, and priests. If we accept the who and the why that I've proposed for this painting, we still need to determine when it might have been produced. In Ali Quli's night scene with the comet from about 1664-65, we find a dark middle ground and sky with light rising or falling above the horizon and figures in the foreground illuminated by a candle. The birds are also illuminated against a dark ground. More to the point is the handling of the paint in both works. Unlike the pictures of the falcon and variegated rooster, Both of these paintings show signs of softening and even correction of the outlines of the bird's neck and the gray beard's nose. Can the birds be dated to the 1660s on the basis of this? I would tentatively place the bird painting in the same general period, say 1665 to 70, but understanding that more research may furnish a more precise date for this painting and a better understanding of how it came into being. And as a postscript, I would like to mention the two figures in the margins. They appear to me to be based on European images of Mary Magdalene and the young St. John the Baptist. The border itself, on the left, can most likely be dated to the mid-18th century and to an artist working in the circle of Mohammed Bakir, but probably not him himself. The relative stiffness of the flowers in this border may indicate that they were painted by, as I say, somebody else, who produced the other, who's other different from the one who did the other floral borders, as we see in detail on the right in the Davis album. But as you can see, even with this one page, a great deal remains to be learned. But I hope today, at least, I've provided a beginning for new research. Thank you. And if there are questions, please fire away. But I can't see you, so you have to go use the mic. Yes? Unfortunately, there's no inscription on this. Oh, yes, but I don't think that there's as much. Yes, of course. When there's script or inscriptions, we absolutely pay attention. Absolutely. No, no, for sure we do. But unfortunately, this one doesn't have that, so we have to go use other means. Yes.
I'm very interested in this question of showing the night. And it's actually connected with something that I've been looking at in terms of Safavid Islamat, the idea that you have all kinds of activities happening at night, that you have the issue of light in night illumination.
Yeah.
And what is interesting about Ali Kumi is that he seems to actually be interested in exactly that aspect of optical discrimination, just at that moment. Although, so this is why you have these lit scenes and not. And I wonder whether that isn't a way of determining his particular interest.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think in this period, it's certainly, in that decade of the 1660s, it's a preoccupation of his and of Muhammad Zaman, and it seems pretty specific to that period, because then his later paintings are not like that. The real question I have, and I mean, it also extends to Payag, because even though the painting that Navina showed us isn't one where chiaroscuro or light and dark is much of a question. He's done many other works where it's central to the composition. And my question is it because of this interest, as you've shown in Isfahan, in illuminations at night and lighting up things, you know, the bridge, the Maidan, whatever, is it because of that possibility that seems to have been greater in the 17th and then on into the 18th century? Or is it a combination of that and the introduction of prints based on European paintings of artists who were working with light and dark? I mean, you know, we know Renaissance artists and even Rembrandt and people like that really were focusing on that more than perhaps, you know, in the earlier.
Of Felix Angel, where you know it's equally fine. There are no fuzzies. That except that here there is an idea that you utilize what seems to be a different way of showing borders between light and dark. For a while, I mean, he explores the point, and then lets go.
Yes, that's exactly what I mean about his intellectual restlessness, and he just is always exploring different types of compositions, different types of prototypes, etc. And therefore, his work, the range of it stylistically, is much greater than Muhammad Zaman. Anyway, anybody else? All right. Oh yes. Hi.
You've written in the past about European prints in Iran in the late 16th, 17th century. Could you just remind us of the specifics of the types of European prints that we know, that were recorded, that were documented as having been circulating around or available for artists like Ali Kili to inspire, as opposed to what we kind of imagine?
Right. Okay. Well, I mean, in the article that I published in 1996, I talked about actually a group of Dutch prints that were by various artists, Goltzius in particular. There were a great number of these, in a shipwreck in a place called Nova Zembla, which is up in the near the North Pole. This ship was on its way through the so-called northern route to Asia. Somehow they thought if they went that way they could get to Asia, and instead the ship sank. Anyway, these prints, this huge sodden wad of prints, all stuck together after centuries of being underwater, was excavated, and the Rijksmuseum's paper conservators, God bless their souls, painstakingly restored and separated these prints. And that, to me, served as evidence of the type of things that were being shipped abroad for commercial purposes. These weren't what people, you know, there are other discussions and descriptions of things that actual people brought in texts, but these things, anyway, were being sent in large numbers. And they weren't the finest work of Goltzius. They were after him. They were kind of, you know, second and third remove, but they were all based on his compositions. And the same goes for other artists like Sadler and a few other of these Dutch artists who were publishers as well, so they were producing huge numbers. Then there are other specific prints such as ones by Virix and Collart and others that we've both, Navina and I, have shown today, that are the precise prototypes for Mughal paintings more than Persian. But the Persian, there was one, and you know, you find them and it's possible to identify some, but not all. And by this period, it's much more mixed. It's as if they're taking a little bit from here and a little bit from there and really being inspired by these ideas rather than slavishly copying. Or at least that's what I believe. Except he does some slavish copies as well. And that first one, his earliest one, is. That is an absolute copy after a Sadler print.
By artists, it seems, at this particular time. And so
interaction with the materia prima that then could lead to other kinds of products, such as what you've shown. Where do those fit? The painting
well, of course, they're appearing in albums compiled in India, more than in Iran, to my knowledge, though I've looked at some albums, and I can't remember which ones at the moment that are Iranian. But in Indian albums, they seem to be so carefully chosen and carefully placed. And I suppose it's an homage to these works and an interest and seeing that they fit in the compiler's eyes with the other materials, because they're often not just the only thing on a page. They're part of a palimpsest of several works on one page. Beyond that, it doesn't always seem that because there's a print in an album that then it's copied somewhere else necessarily. But it's a question something I've always wanted to pursue and gather more information, because they certainly do appear all over the place. But anyway, that's the more research part of the equation. Anybody else? Okay, thank you very much.
Priscilla Soucek is the third and final speaker for today's morning session. She is the John L. Loeb Professor in Art History and the Director of Graduate Studies at the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University. Her research interests include Persian and Arabic manuscripts, portraiture, and history of collecting. She served as a senior consultant at the Met and contributed extensively in guiding us through the reinstallation project of the new galleries. She's the author of Content and Context of the Visual Arts in the Islamic World and co-author of the recent publication Masterpieces from the Department of Islamic Art in the Metropolitan Museum. And she has numerous publications. Everybody here knows quite extensive list of publications in the field of Persian art and Islamic art in general. The title of her paper is Literary History and Popular Mythology in a 15th Century Persian Manuscript. Join me in welcoming Priscilla Soucek, but before she comes up, I would like to remind you that after this talk, we will resume at 1:40 for the afternoon session right here. Thank you.
Good morning. My paper represents a change of pace and also, I would say, a rather different kind of issue because the manuscript that I am going to discuss is something which has never really before been studied and about which a great deal remains to be learned. So this is a kind of early stage investigation. In 1995, the Metropolitan Museum purchased a small manuscript in Persian with 86 folios that has yet to be studied in depth. Several aspects of it are unusual, and for that reason, I decided to speak about it today at this conference devoted to new research on the museum's collection. One of the most enigmatic aspects of this book is its identity, because neither its author nor title has been established. In the absence of this information, I will use the manuscript's museum identification number, 1995.175, in the place of a name. Although I do hope to eventually discover who composed 1995.175 and this book's proper name, In the interim, it is possible to investigate this manuscript's purpose and intended audience by surveying its content and examining its illustrations. Much of Persian literature is didactic. Books of advice come in various forms and were directed at a variety of audiences. This particular example, of which we see here the first and last pages, the last page on the left, the first page on the right, is a prose essay that uses excerpts from the Quran to establish its major themes. A clue as to the text's date of composition is provided by the fact that it includes quotations from Jalaluddin Rumi's long poetic text, the Masnavi Imanavi, from the late 13th century. Its Persian sections employ many Arabic words and phrases. This literary style gained popularity during the 14th and 15th centuries, and that circumstance provides an approximate date range for this text composition. 1995.175 places particular stress on the importance and behavior of Muslim religious authorities, and its author may have been drawn from their ranks. The final page here, shown on the left, has a decorated colophon. Both this colophon's text and its decorative embellishment are unusual and not typical of Persian manuscripts from the 14th and 15th centuries. The flowing vines with leaves and blossoms that flank the colophon's text lack the precision and of drawing and density of ornament typical for Persian manuscripts of the 14th and early 15th century. Here I show you a sort of mid-15th century ornament from another manuscript. That distinction is easily seen when comparing the colophon's page's ornamental panels with the kind of illumination found in the illustrations of the same manuscript, 1995.175. Such as the spandrels of the structure shown on folio 89B. Although both sets of decoration, both the colophon decoration and the building's decoration, share a color scheme of gold on a blue ground, they differ in the density and precision of their execution. The extraordinary skill of Persian illuminators permitted them to execute ornamental patterns with a precision which is rarely attained today. Thus, I believe that the ornament seen around the colophon of 1995.175 is, in fact, of recent date. Further questions are raised by the words used in the colophon and by the way the text begins. In order to demonstrate why these are unusual, it is useful to compare them with other examples. Here we see, again, the opening and closing pages of 1995-175. It is customary, indeed obligatory, for a Persian text to begin with the invocation of God's name. As we see, the text of 1995.175 begins instead with a reference to the Quran. And this comment is followed immediately by a citation of the Quranic text written in gold script. This leads me to conclude that the opening words of 1995-175 have indeed been lost. They may be concealed under the illuminated heading, which was at some point pasted onto this opening page, or they may have been on a page which we no longer have. Thus, for whatever reason, we lack this text's opening section, a fact which complicates its identification. If the opening page of 1995-175 has lost part of its original text, what remains is genuine and original. The questions raised by the colophon of 1995.175 are, however, of a different order. It is unusual as a colophon and unique, to my knowledge, in both tone and content. The typical colophon of a Persian manuscript is couched as a prayer of thanksgiving composed by the scribe in gratitude for the fact that his task has been completed. This prayer is therefore linked so thematically to the invocation with which a manuscript begins. Often the colophon contains additional information. Sometimes a book's title is repeated. Often the scribe includes his own name, as well as the date at which this transcription was completed. At times, the scribe will even make discursive comments. However, in my experience, the contents of the colophon of 1995-175 are unique. This text represents an encapsulated history of the Persian language and its literature, which is offered as a history of the book itself. This colophon claims that Zoroaster was the text's author. It is well known that Zoroaster was a founder of a religious movement that survives until today, but this text bears no relation to the religious texts of that faith. As I will explain, the text is 1995-175, reflects the beliefs and practices of Islam. There is no ambiguity about that matter. Now, the colophon further claims that the text had been composed in the pre-Islamic form of Persian, which now in modern times has come to be known as Pahlavi. This statement, too, I believe, is to be rejected, as are the further contentions in this colophon that the text was translated eventually from Pahlavi into Dari and from Dari into Farsi. In sum, in my opinion, this colophon was created quite recently as part of what one might call, quote, a marketing exercise, unquote. It is thus possible that the manuscript's original colophon lies beneath the surface we see today. If so, it may eventually be possible to read it, but for the present, we need to use the contents and style of this text in order to study it. The conclusion of my research to date on 1995-175 is that it is a didactic religious text written by a Muslim author for a Muslim audience. Its main purpose is to guide individuals to the attainment of salvation through the repetition of stories and anecdotes. The book's illustrations underscore its didactic intent and are in harmony with this textual message. Now, in the case of the last page, the lines above the colophon are original and in harmony with the book's underlying goals and content as a book of religious instruction. But because the text is written in a rather ponderous and heavily Arabicized form of Persian, I find that the book's opening pages provide a more comprehensible guide to the book's underlying purpose. Normally, as I mentioned earlier, the first initial page of a manuscript or pages would reveal a book's title and identify its author. In the case of 1995.175, as I have mentioned already, that information is unfortunately missing. And this leads me to conclude, as I said earlier, that the initial pages has been lost. And the initial page has an illuminated heading, which at this point is so damaged that the title is unreadable. So we lack really the basic tools with which one usually identifies an author and a title. Now, still, the text itself is its own best source of information. And as I mentioned earlier also, I think that in this particular book, quotations from the Quran are actually the sort of armature around which the text is constructed. The initial quotation, which you see, is Surah 3:152 in translation, "Among those are they who value this world and those who value the hereafter." This distinction between the truly pious and those who pursue worldly goals is a theme which is reiterated repeatedly in both the book's text and its illustrations. This dichotomy between those who seek salvation and those who are distracted by the affairs of the world is also elaborated on the next Quranic quotation, which makes a distinction between the, and the text following the quotation, distinguishes between the elite and the ordinary citizen, between good and evil, between friend and foe. So this dichotomy between salvation and the sort of attention to this world is carried also into a kind of a moral plane. This basic dichotomy is also stressed in the second Quranic citation on this page, which comes from Surah 30, verse 70. They only know the outward appearance of this life, but they are completely ignorant of the hereafter. So again, going back to this theme of the present world and the future world. The text following page introduces another theme, and I'm sorry. The text following page introduces another theme, the role of prophets in guiding people towards salvation. As the Quranic citation suggests here on the page on the left, some prophets have offered true guidance, but others have not. And that's the Quran. And then it sort of transitions into a discussion of Muhammad. In the case of Muhammad, however, there's no such ambiguity, and his message has been always clear and consistent. This theme is visually encapsulated in the painting of the prophet and of Gabriel. The prophet's active observance of Islamic rituals is emphasized by the prayer carpet shown on the floor below. The book's special flavor, however, comes from its broader engagement with the moral character and piety of a broader spectrum of God's creatures. Some of the anecdotes concern angels, others focus on demons or shaitans, and still others have as protagonists birds and animals. In the account of the world's creation, the text mentions, following this introduction, it goes into a section talking about creation and what happened in the sort of stages of creation, that there were successive creations of demons, angels, and human beings. So this broader perspective is also encapsulated in a Quranic citation, Surah 6, verse 112, which is on a following page. Thus we have appointed unto every prophet an adversary, the devils of humankind and jinn who conspire in each other through guile, and these adversaries lead man astray. As an example of this opposition within creation between good and evil, the text introduces the story of the fall of Iblis, the leader of the demons. This text narrative, largely drawn from the Quran, is accompanied by an illustration which depicts the moment of the fall of this head demon, Iblis. He is shown in the picture's upper right corner, gazing in perplexity at the newly created character of Adam, who is being honored by angels who approach him bearing gifts. This event follows the description in the Quran, 38:71-78, parts of which are included in blue and gold script on this page. And I'm now giving the larger context because I think you need not just the quotation, but the sort of the passage from which it comes to understand what we're seeing. Surely I'm going to create, says God speaking, surely I'm going to create a mortal from dust. So when I have made him complete and breathed into him of my spirit, now this is addressed to the angels, then fall down, making obeisance to him. The angels did obeisance, all of them, except Iblis, and he was proud, and he is one of the unbelievers, and that actually you see there. In keeping with this text's aim of providing moral guidance, it also includes examples, and this is quite, I think, quite extraordinary, bad behavior among the religious class. Here we find the image of four men who are helping themselves to food from a communal dish. As the text itself tells us, these individuals have substituted the love of food for observation of religious duties.
They have, quote, pretended that the excessive consumption of food and fermented beverages is equivalent to religious poverty. And they have confused the abandonment of the Sharia and the refusal to submit to God with the attainment of religious insight. The Quran had these people in mind in the text 19, Surah 19, verse 59. And now there has succeeded them, a later generation, and this is what we see on the page, who have abandoned prayer and followed lust. This text goes on to claim that some of these miscreants have actually descended into heresy. Another book, a group of people who appear at first glance to be the religiously pious are actually demons or shaitans who take on the outward appearance of the religious, is citing proof of the verse I mentioned earlier of Surah 6, verse 112, which describes how prophets have had adversaries that are in fact devils in human form, who inspire each other through guile. Here we see the false prophet on the left, who seems, he's got something in his hand, who seems to be talking to the person diagonally opposite from him, while two more spectators look on in perplexity. After further discussion of religious devotees, and he has, for example, a page about religious figures that he calls Iblishui, with devotees with the temperament of the devil, the author moves on to consider other aspects of creation. He mentions in passing the creation of women, although none are portrayed. Their appearance is followed in the order of creation by that of the birds and the animals. The text turns to the discussion of the animals. And as I said, I've not really totally read this book, so I don't actually quite know all the transitions. But anyway, we shift gears at a certain point. So these animals are described as having been attracted to the court of a ruler who has dominion over the jinns and demons, as well as over people and animals. The text refers to him repeatedly as the ruler of the jinn, but from his depiction on folio 39A, surrounded by a court, we see that he is being at least visually equated with the prophetic figure, Solomon. And notable around him, which the sort of representation of Solomon is quite common in manuscript illustration, also appears on metalwork of the 15th century, 14th and 15th century. Notable among the creatures gathered around the ruler's throne is the hoopoe or hudhud, who's shown on the upper right. Let's see if I can make this thing point. I think he's up just above the head of Solomon and to the right. Who has a long history of serving as Solomon's messenger and is much mentioned in various texts. The introduction of this theme of the ruler of the jinn surrounded by animals is followed by a series of episodes which describe communication between this ruler and various animals and among the animals themselves. The next illustrated episode depicts a group of animals in conversation with an angel. The two main speakers are a fox, who's shown in the upper right, you can see he's got his mouth open, and a lion, who's in the middle of the picture. According to this text, this fox named Abul Hakam is explicating the difference between good and evil. So this seems also to go back to this theme of good and evil, of guidance and misguidance, which is the kind of underlying sort of charge of the text as a whole. Many Persian didactic texts are arranged according to lessons for the days of the week, or for regions of the world. So these are two organizing principles in text. You have sometimes stories arranged by geography, sometimes arranged by chronology of the days of the week. In this particular text, these arrangement is that there are animals who communicate with different rulers of the world on different days of the week. So it sort of brings together these different modes of organization. These combinations include an ant and the ruler of Syria, a fox and the ruler of the Turks, and what we see here, a bird named the Huma and the ruler of Khorasan. And he is shown down below. Can you see him? He's sort of, I can't see him very well, but he's down in the front of the picture. And actually, if you remember the pictures, what Sheila has shown us of falcons on their perch, I think he's a bird of prey. I think he's a falcon. And he's on his little perch there in the middle of this audience scene. And everybody is obviously listening very intently to what he's telling them. In many cases, the Huma was imagined as a mythical creature and is depicted differently in different periods of Persian art. In this case, the model seems to be a raptor, such as a hawk or falcon, who is shown sitting on his perch in the audience hall of this ruler's court. Unfortunately, I've not been able yet to read the whole story that concerns this bird, but his beneficence and wisdom are underscored by the fact that we see a demonic figure fleeing the scene through the door to the right, and assorted angels and human beings hanging eagerly on the Huma's words of wisdom. A predominant stylistic feature of the paintings in 1995-175 is their simplicity, and you see a painting on the left. Most include only a pair of figures, and often the background is devoid of detail except for a few scattered plants. These very qualities make these pictures difficult to date and localize, but they would fit comfortably within the first decades of the 15th century. Furthermore, their style and execution resembles that used in manuscripts known to have produced in the southern Iranian city of Shiraz. Here we see an early 15th century manuscript from Shiraz. Here is a sort of mid-century manuscript from Shiraz. And here is an even later one. So, this is not a very refined discussion, but you can see this sort of traits, this very simple landscape and kind of clumps of leaves and flowers that sort of, or a sort of trademark of these pictures for a very long period of time. Thus, we can say with some confidence that 1995-175 was produced during the 15th century in the city of Shiraz. Many paintings from that center show a similar kind of landscape, reduced to a semicircle and dotted with plants. What makes these paintings in 1995-175 more compelling to me is the way they engage the abstract content of the text. Seen from that direction, they represent an attempt to visualize and moral and ethical concepts, rather than to illustrate the events of epics and romances, which are the predominant texts to be illustrated in Iran of this period. The very fact that this manuscript reflects the artistic repertoire and accomplishments of a segment of Persian society, not often represented in the collections of our museums and interests, adds to their interest. So indeed, it was produced from someone in a clerical environment and had a clerical audience in mind. This is really a very different public than most of the manuscripts that we know. Whoever created these pictures was familiar with the pictorial conventions of his day that are well represented in more standard illustrated texts. This can be seen in the most elaborate of the paintings in 1995-175, which shows the Huma offering advice to the ruler of Khorasan. The building used to house that ruler's court is very similar in construction to the architectural frame around an illustration to the Shahnameh of Ferdowsi, produced in the middle decades of the 15th century. Although I have not been able to establish the title and author of 1995-175, I do believe that its general purpose and message are abundantly clear. As I said, the present colophon is modern. The fact that it's modern does not negate the value of the book, nor its importance to this museum's collection. In further study, I hope to eventually establish more facts than I have been able to outline today as my research progresses, and in due course prepare a publication which will make this unusual manuscript and its contents better known. Thank you. So, Mariam, we should break for lunch, do you think? Oh, yes, okay. I can't see you very well, so. Yes, Sheila. Well, I don't know. I mean, I just have to say that my stage of study as manuscript is still an early point, and I have, you know, looked through the book a few times and sort of noted titles, but I haven't of sections, but I haven't really been able to read the text. So there may lurk in that unread, those many unread folios, something more particular. But I would say in general tone of it is sort of on a slightly less particular plane and really deals with Islam as a practice, of religious practice, I think, on a more conceptual level. So there may be something motivating it, but I mean the issues it raises of the distraction from religious observance caused by attention to the world and its sort of riches, is a very kind of routine theme in religious texts. And so at this point, I would say I don't know that there's a particular reason, but there could you know, it's possible that there was a trigger that I will eventually be able to isolate that's more specific than what I'm telling you today. Renata? Well, one gets this sort of script in prose, and I think it's in keeping with what I feel is the book's didactic purpose, to make it legible. It's very clearly written. It's very carefully written. It's vocalized in large extent. And, you know, that may suggest also that it was written not for the cleric at an advanced stage of development, but perhaps even its students, or people who were sort of novices in this way of life, and that therefore, and for whom perhaps Arabic was not their first language, and even the Persian, which is very Arabicized, there's vocalization in many, many places in the text, which is quite precise and complete. So again, I think this kind of goes along the sort of teaching vein to me. Yes.
The mention of Zoroaster is made in this more recent edition, and are there any other examples of such an addition or attribution being made?
Well, Zoroastrian texts exist. The texts of Zoroastrian content which still survive were written down in the Islamic period, because prior to Islam, the religious tradition in Zoroastrianism itself was the oral transmission of texts from generation to generation. And it's only when Islam began to make inroads in the community and its members began to dwindle that they really began seriously to record their scriptures. So there are plenty of texts which are Zoroastrian in content that were made in the Islamic period. As to why someone claimed that Zoroaster had written this extraordinarily Islamic text, I really am at a loss to say, except that it possibly was someone trying to present the manuscript in an attractive light to a purchaser. I mean, that was my reconstruction, but I don't know really much more than that.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes. I don't know. These are very small. That's the other thing. These, when you see them on the screen, you know, they're very, very enlarged because the whole manuscript is about 5 inches tall and about 3.5 inches across. So the pictures are tiny. And I didn't notice that, but it's possible they've been retouched. I mean, that can always happen.
The reason I bring that up is because I wonder if the new addition to the manuscript, the colophon with its Zoroastrian content, might have been to appeal to an audience in India
that's possible.
Zoroaster would have made this work more attractive.
That's true. I mean, the Zoroastrian community in Iran is very reduced, whereas the Zoroastrian community of India, which is more robust and so forth, you know, that's possible. There's, in the book's present state, there's really no historical information about its earlier phases or its owners or anything of that sort that I've been able to, you know, there are no stamps or information that would tell us how this book has passed from hand to hand since it was made in the middle 15th century. Yes, there. If you could come to the microphone.
I have a tangential curious question, and it's whether that image you showed us of the four impostors of piety, are there any signs in that image that they are impostors?
It's from the text.
It's only from the text, but not in the image. Yeah.
The people, you're talking about the one with the person who's the false, giving false information as opposed to the gluttons? Or
no, they're four men seated in a kind of a circle, I think.
Oh, those are the gluttons, I think. Let me just go back and see. I think it's gone away. Sorry.
What I wrote is that you said they were impostors of piety. Do you remember that?
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, that's the text. I was just using the text to describe it.
And my question was whether you see signs in the image of there being impostors, or is that something you can only project on the text if you know?
In many cases, you have to interpret the pictures through the text because the pictures are fairly generic looking. And I think it was a complicated sort of issue to depict. And the painter's skills and repertoire, had a certain limit in terms of expressiveness. And that's why I think it's only after you really look at the text carefully that you can kind of see what's happening in most cases. Some of the other scenes are a little more obvious, but those people sitting around, my interpretation is based exclusively on what it says in the book about them. I mean, although occasionally there's a gesture that maybe helps a little bit. I think it's a kind of an unusual experiment.
The next question might be, after you have the interpretation, to look and see if you can read, you find objective traces of signs that they're imposters. I just think that's an interesting question.
Thank you. That's a good idea. I will think about that. All right. Well,
any other questions? Thank you. I was wondering if you have any information regarding the provenance of the manuscript, since you suggested that the first page is missing. I wonder if it's related to the way it's been passed on from one owner to the next.
Well, I think maybe I wasn't clear. I think at this point, the book has no traces of previous ownership in it, except what I've been able to kind of read into the colophon question. But I mean, that doesn't really tell us very much, actually, that's specific. It's not uncommon for a manuscript that has come through the art market to have all traces of its past obliterated. And I mean, that's actually quite a routine proposition, unfortunately, which makes the history of a book's transmission from person to person, you know, after it's having been written, extremely difficult, if not impossible, to reconstruct in many cases. I didn't talk about the binding, which I also think is a later addition to the project, but it's not very specific either. I mean, it might be 16th century binding, possibly, but that doesn't help too much either, because bindings don't change all that much from moment to moment. All right, well, thank you.
Thank you, Priscilla Soucek. We'll break for lunch and return at 1:40 right here.